To be part of the greatest academic program in neurosurgery, you must have technical excellence. You must be hungry for a high case volume and the toughest of surgeries. And you've got to have movie star good looks. I'm Robert Spetzler, and I led Barrow Neurological Institute for 34 years as its president and CEO. During my time overseeing Barrow, I performed more than 6,400 aneurysm surgeries. I also helped develop the use of cardiac standstill procedure to safely treat vessel problems deep in the brain. And along with my dear friend and Barrow Emeritus Vice Chair, Volker Sontag, we, along with the rest of our team, grew Barrow to become the home of the largest neurosurgical residency program in the country, and in my humble opinion, by far the best. And I even taught this particular guy, Michael Lawton. He's my successor, and as president and CEO, he is charting new path for Barrow. He was a superlative resident, and it is an incredible honor to have him take over the chair and keep moving the slope of the BNI in an upward direction. And now he's shaping education for the next generation of neurosurgeons. For Barrow Neurosurgery residents, the end of the day brings teaching rounds where the most complicated cases are discussed. Challenges are accepted, norms are rejected, and boundaries are pushed.
These come together really nicely. All we've done is just basically taken them apart, moved them out and around, and brought them back together again.
You're about to get insider access to discussions like you've never had before. Come with us as Michael Lawton leads us up a trail from the Barrow Neurosurgery Base Camp to the summit of neurosurgical excellence.
All right, time for base camp. Let's hit the trail.
This first case is a 72-year-old male, cranial nerve 6 palsy, as well as balancing difficulties. On exam today, he continues to have persistent tinnitus and balance difficulties.
James, why don't you tell us how you would manage this guy?
In terms of intervention?
You've got a huge hint right here. So if you were going to treat that surgically, how would you do it?
Sometimes you use a Gore-Tex sling for these. I think that's an option, so you could do a sling.
So you want to get this knuckle kind of going this way?
Yeah, even just a little bit, just so it's not, you know, constantly pulsating in the nerve.
The other vert, we don't have an angiogram, but it's basically a very small hypoplastic that comes in right about like that, right on the undersurface of that curve. You can see it on the axial CT, the basilar, like so. It kind of lives in this zone that's about that wide. And as these patients age, this artery basically gets much longer. It elongates this way. And when it gets so long but has the same space to live in, what happens is it has to buckle. So what you end up with is all that extra length that's being generated has to buckle over here in order to fit in that same compartment space. So all that length here gets turned into this U-turn over there. As it buckles laterally, cranial nerves are laying right over the top. 7 and 8 are right over the top. So this just progressively drives into the nerve. If you asked 100 neurosurgeons what they do, probably 99 wouldn't even treat it. The ones that would treat it would probably pat it. But I've always felt that moving the artery with the sling in this direction, where you go kind of moving that artery away from the nerve, so medially and forward is the way. But if you look at this case, there's so much vessel. Basically have all of this artery here, it's about 4 centimeters of extra artery. So pushing all that artery medially is it's hard to get rid of that. It's still gonna be a lot of vessel to be impacting the nerve or to be slinging over. What we did was something different. So instead of the sling, and instead of pulling the artery, what we ended up doing was basically transecting vertebral artery. This is the V4 segment. We interrupted it here and here, And then we rerouted them to the other side of the nerves this way and did a reanastomosis. We now moved the arteries from being under the nerves and pushing them up to being lateral to the nerves and going around it. Because of what we were thinking about doing, you really want to maximize your exposure, so it's important to get all the way around the mastoid tip and make sure that this exposure down here, this lower rim, is as wide as you can get it. When you first open up, the cerebellum gets pretty full, and you see how relaxed the cerebellum becomes after you release the CSF. It's important to make that your first move. So, oh, here's another interesting thing. We found that the ICA, which was coming off above all of these, all of that knuckle of the artery, was adherent to the petrous dura here. So one of the first things we had to do was to take this artery and free it from those adhesions there. This is the basilar artery here. It's actually the V4 segment right before the basilar origination, but you can see here's that knuckle of artery coming around like this. And you can see how the seventh and eighth nerves are draped right over that. So that force of the knuckle is right into the nerves like that. That's the dissection of the lower cranial nerves. You can see the impaction of the artery on the nerves. We're gonna do a dominant vert occlusion, transection, rerouting, and reanastomosis. What's one of the biggest concerns?
Your ischemic time.
This is V4 on the right side. And the V4 on the left side is actually coming around like this. So that's left V4. And this is basilar artery down here where they come together, continuing around. Put our temporary clips here and here and isolate that segment of the artery. We had this guy feeding the basilar, so there was no ischemia time. This was a no-risk thing. If this were a basilar tortuosity and we were doing this on the basilar segment without this, then we'd have really dangerous ischemia time. So, but this finding here really allowed us to do that. What nerve is this, Rob?
10.
So you got 9, 10, and then how about this one here?
11 coming up.
Yeah, 11. So those are the lower cranial nerves here. This is 7 and 8 up here. And you can see that anatomy. You've got one nerve bundle here, one bundle here, and another bundle a little bit further medially. And what's this right here? So this is Dandy's vein right here, all right? And then what's this guy right there? That's your trigeminal, right? So there's a good overview of the nerves, and you can see how the artery is pushing up all these little, this is the 7/8 complex here. All the different fascicles are being draped over that. And that's where that knuckle rises the highest. You can see that the only thing keeping that artery contained is those nerve bundles. I realized that a sling wasn't gonna do it. This is moving the artery over. We could have just pulled it forward, but I didn't feel like this was gonna be a good long-term solution. There's the three nerve bundles coming in. We decided to do our rerouting. So we've got temporary clips now on the inflow and outflow. This is inflow here, it's the outflow over here, and you can see that I've transected them, and now I've rerouted them lateral to the nerve. The artery now comes on the outside of the nerve bundle, so I've looped this end here over all the different rootlets of the 7 and 8, these ends coming on the outside. So now there's going to be no further impaction on the nerve bundle. You just have to get this artery put back together again. It's a deep corridor. To get the back suture wall sewn, it's an interluminal suture technique. So you've got the two openings of the vessel here, and you're sewing the deep walls together from the inside. So it's tricky. And the tissue is very thick, the basilar, or actually this is actually the terminal V4. You can see how thick that tissue is. You've got to make sure that you get good bites through all the right layers. You can see how these come together really nicely. All we've done is just basically taken them apart, moved them out and around, and brought them back together again. And here's the final views. Here's our V4. Here's the nerve. Now it's on the inside. There's 5 up there. 7, 8 here, 9, 10 down here, and the artery comes in between. This is triangle between the cochlea and the ninth window. It comes through this triangle space here, loops around the nerves and then goes back in up above. The nice thing about this solution is that that continues to grow in a direction this way. So that loop can actually continue to elongate. It doesn't matter. It can fill all of this space out here. So it's like a free range vertebral artery, and it can continue. His pathology can progress without any symptoms. I haven't done this before. It was perfect for all the reasons we talked about. There was no ischemic risk. The tissues were good. It just seemed like the perfect chance to try this. I think of this disease in a couple different forms. There's the one form that's the type that gets dilated and dolichoectatic in a round way, aneurysms that become compressive and they grow and they, you know, they have the terrible outcomes. These are the different ones. These are the elongating vertebrobasilar ones. So it's not growing in that direction that you would be wrapping. But I think this idea of basically uncoupling the artery, rerouting it, and recoupling it is a nice way to do this, particularly in the setting of a contralateral vert that's big enough to get you through that. I tried something different, transected the distal V4 segment. I rerouted them lateral to the seventh and eighth cranial nerves, so each half was brought around the nerve bundle, and then I did an end-to-end reanastomosis of the V4 segment to reconstitute that. Difficult bypass, hard to do that deep wall. The opening of the retrosig is very tight, it's bumping up against the edges. Difficult to sew the deep wall, but the more superficial wall was very easy. Had a good run on that second suture line, came together nicely. A good opposite vertebral artery, the V4 segment on the other side, fed the basilar, so there was no ischemia time for this. Seemed to be well tolerated, no changes in the evoked potentials, no changes in the bears. We've done something different here, and I think, you know, time will tell whether that relieves the symptoms. I think it will.